Hey everybody, welcome to the 6th grade podcast. Today we're going to be talking about tools that are used to predict the weather. We're going to be looking at those tools and how meteorologists use those tools to predict the weather. So let's get started. What is meteorology? Meteorology is the study of the atmosphere. We're looking at what's going on in the atmosphere and how that changes over time and what kind of weather that brings as it's changing. So, the tools that we're going to be looking at today, the first, air temperature. The air temperature is measured with a thermometer. You should be very familiar with a thermometer. Anybody talking about what the temperature is outside, they're going to be using a thermometer. So, the thermometer tells us how hot or cold the air outside is, or even inside. They can be measured using two different systems, either Fahrenheit or Celsius. Something that's pretty important to remember is here in the United States, we use Fahrenheit. So the green measurements over here, these are all Fahrenheit. And the Celsius is the metric system, which is pretty much what the rest of the world uses. Since we are science teachers and you're a scientist when you're in our room, we're going to make sure that we know Celsius as well as we know Fahrenheit. So something important to remember is our freezing point is at 32 degrees Fahrenheit. Now in the Celsius scale, it's 0 degrees. So 0 degrees Celsius is freezing. Anything above that is above freezing. Anything below 0 degrees Celsius is freezing, very cold. So that's the big thing to remember with air temperature. We use a thermometer. It can be measured using Fahrenheit or Celsius. It tells us how hot or cold it is. The next is relative humidity. Relative humidity, when anyone's talking about how humid it is outside or how sticky the outside air feels, they're talking about humidity. The humidity is simply how much water vapor is in the air. We use two different tools to tell us what the humidity is outside. We use a sling psychrometer and the hygrometer. Relative humidity is measured in percentages. So like if we say it's 100% humidity outside, that means that it cannot hold any more water vapor. It's at 100%. It's at full capacity. So on Monday morning, we had 88% humidity. That means that it had 88% of the saturation rate that it could possibly hold.
Okay, so now we're going to talk about air pressure. The thing about air pressure is it's talking about how hard or how much the air molecules in the atmosphere are pressing down on us. So when we talk about air pressure, specifically we just talk about it being really just high or low. The air pressure is measured with a tool called a barometer. This is a picture of a barometer right here. When you look at it, we've got 28 here, 29 here, 30 here, 31 here. So lying anywhere between 28 and 29, we would expect cloudy, rainy weather. Laying between 29 and 30, we would expect maybe partly cloudy, maybe some clouds, maybe not clouds, kind of somewhere in between. And then between 30 and 31 here, we would expect to have clear skies. So the unit we use when we talk about mercury, or when we talk about air pressure, is we use inches of mercury. Okay, that is the standard unit that we use. So we say like maybe it's 29 inches of mercury, or maybe it's 30.48 inches of mercury. You might also see it measured in millibars. So the abbreviation for millibars is MB. And when you see that, it'd be something like 1,031 millibars. That's the metric unit for air pressure. So again, high pressure, this would be like 31 to 30 inches of mercury. Would be clear skies, good weather. Low pressure, on the other hand, would be like somewhere between 28 and 29 inches of mercury, and we would expect cloudy, rainy weather if that were the case. Next, we'll talk about wind. Wind is just air that is moving. Please remember that wind is caused by differences in air pressure, that the air will move from areas of high pressure to areas of low pressure. So it's measured with an anemometer. This right here, in this picture, that part right there is an anemometer where it's got the little cuppy things. And when the wind blows, the cups catch the air and it causes the whole apparatus to spin. And depending on how fast it spins, that tells us how hard the wind is blowing. Okay, so the unit we use for the speed of the wind is the same unit we use for pretty much the speed of everything, which is miles per hour. All right, there are a couple of other tools that are used to measure wind. There's a weather vane. This is an example of a weather vane right here. It'll tell us the direction. It's the same as like the weather vane that you see in like movies and TV and stuff like that, where they'll have like northeast, southwest, and maybe have like a rooster or something on the top of it. That just tells us the direction of the wind is blowing. And there's also something called a wind sock. It looks kind of like this, and it'll like flap in the wind. And what happens is the wind enters into the larch part, and it causes the tail of the sock to be pointing in the direction that the wind is blowing. So again, wind speed is measured by the anemometer, but wind direction is measured by the weather vane or the wind sock. Okay, last thing I'm going to talk about today is dew point. Now, the dew point is kind of, it's a little bit more confusing, and it has to do with both the humidity and the temperature. So that's why when we talk about dew point, we use the hygrometer and the thermometer. If you remember, the hygrometer is used to measure humidity, whereas the thermometer is used to measure the temperature. So the dew point is really just the point at which dew forms. Now, if you're not sure what dew is, it's the water droplets that form a lot of times on like the grass or the car, or when you wake up in the morning and things are wet, that's because of the dew. Now, the water doesn't just show up out of nowhere. What happens is the water vapor that has that is in the air, which is what we call humidity, and we measure by a hygrometer. Okay, the water vapor gets cooled down overnight. Cooled down, temperature, thermometer. Okay, it gets cooled down overnight, and it condenses, just like we learned with clouds in the water cycle. When water vapor cools down, it condenses. And when it condenses, it has to stick to something, so it sticks to the grass. So the dew point tells us specifically what temperature the air is completely saturated. Saturated means full, with water. So when is the humidity completely full to where the temperature has to, when the temperature drops, it causes the water to condense. Okay, since we are talking about a specific temperature, the unit for dew point is degrees Fahrenheit or also degrees Celsius.
The last two things on here, the first thing we're going to talk about is Doppler radar. If you've ever watched the news, you've heard about Doppler radar, and a lot of the news stations like to say they've got the newest Doppler radar or super Doppler radar. And all it really is there are satellites in outside of Earth's atmosphere that are going to track precipitation. You can see on here that there's different colors of precipitation, where you have some really dark colors. You have green, you have some blue up here. It's color-coded based on the type of precipitation and how heavy it is. Basically, the unit of measurement, since we've talked about tools and units of measurement, what this is going to measure is going to be precipitation, and the unit of measurement for it is simply the color coding on it. And then finally, we want to talk just a moment about the jet stream. This is not a tool that's used in tracking weather, but this is a narrow belt of high-speed winds. They're in the upper troposphere. They don't follow a regular pattern, which means you don't look at this map and say, okay, this is how the jet stream always is, and it's always right in this position. This jet stream will dip down at times and push south, and when it does, it'll push some of that colder air from the Canada, or even colder air up here that's going to be wet and cold off of the coast of Alaska and Canada, and push it down, and as it pushes it down, it can change our weather pattern. The difference between the jet stream and global winds, if you remember on currents, global winds follow a specific pattern. This does not follow one specific pattern and maintain it all the time. This pattern will change slightly, even to a large degree at some times. That's all we have. Make sure you look over your notes. Make sure you pay attention to the different units, what everything measures. You'll do fantastic on your quiz. We're going to move from this, and then next week we're going to talk about fronts and air masses.
Do you remember what the buttons were? Do you need to close it down?
Shift minus 2.